We have Lindsay Holmwood, and Lindsay is Chief Product Officer at Cipherstash, and he's a product and engineering leader. He's has deep experience in the DevOps space, specializing in DevTools experience, operating safely at speed, and changing organizational culture. And Lindsay also won third place at the 1996 Sydney Royal Easter Show Lego Building Competition. So pretty awesome. And as always, during Lindsay's talk, please, if you have any questions, just chuck them in the chat, and we'll do a little Q&A afterwards if we have time. So thank you, Lindsay.
Awesome. Thanks, Chris. I've been coasting on the success of that Royal Easter Show third place ever since. So today, I'm going to be talking a little about leveling up database security by applying things that have, you know, big advancements that have happened in the API space over the last decade, and how that can help us improve the security posture overall. So I'm Lindsay Holmwood, as I was introduced. I'm Oxesis there on Twitter, in case you want to shout out while I'm giving the talk. I'm the Chief Product Officer over at Cipherstash, and doing product at Cipherstash means that I've spent a lot of time thinking about the broader landscape and how our product fits into that, but also just paying attention to you know, the really important trends around data and security. And the real problem that we have in the data and the data space is that we've seen this huge advancement, particularly in the API space, for building and securing APIs, and the techniques that we've been using there have come in leaps and bounds over the last decade or so. But the problem is that a lot of that has happened in isolation. It hasn't trickled down to other parts of the stack, like particularly the database. And you could say with fairly easily that the database security is actually mostly unchanged looking at this decade versus the decade before. And this is really problematic because our use of technology and internet and you know, the amount of data that we're generating is just increasing at an exponential rate. And the consequences of that are that we see, you know, huge numbers of data breaches, you know, almost on a daily basis. The average cost of a data breach in last year was about $4.24 million. And that's just the average cost. You can see that there's a wide spread here of costs across different industries, like healthcare in particular. The average cost of a data leak, a data breach, is about $9.23 million, all the way down to the other end of public sector, which is about 1.93. The average cost of an individual record leaked of PII is about $180 per record. So you can see that this adds up pretty quickly, because typically when you have some sort of data breach, it's not of a single record, it's a whole bunch of different records. And this trend is only accelerating. You know, we've seen a 10% increase in the average total cost of the breaches between 2020 and 2021. And that's just a continuing upward trend at this point. The landscape as well that we're all operating in is changing quite significantly as well. So we're seeing increasing compliance requirements. You probably have all, you know, lived with the effects of GDPR and CCPA. And, you know, those are the base level restrictions and regulations that we have in place for handling data about people. And they're only becoming more and more stringent. I think we can expect a US, a whole of US equivalent to the GDPR sometime in the next couple of years. And conversely, a lot of this regulation is coming into effect because the operations of cyber criminals is you know, that it's becoming super impactful. Ransomware itself cost about $20 billion, at least $20 billion, worldwide in 2020. And the attackers that are trying to access this data and use it for various purposes, they're becoming far more sophisticated. You know, we've seen particularly over the last year a lot of attacks on the supply chain overall, you know, from the hardware through to the software. And then we see quite sophisticated criminal organizations and enterprises springing up that are even just there to, say, gain access to an environment and then broker that access to other crews of cyber criminals who are going to use that access for whatever the purpose is. And they're just increasing their tempo on a day-by-day basis. And there's tons of breaches, as you can see there. And this has got really real-world impacts. It's not just financial. It's actually got an impact on people on a day-to-day basis. So last year, Vastaamo, which was a Finnish health tech company that is now actually bankrupt, has gone out of business. They had 300,000 patient records, including detailed consult notes from psych sessions. They were leaked And not only were they leaked, but the people who gained access to those were using it to extort those people to say, you know, pay us a bunch of money and we won't release your information. And there were a bunch of suicides out of that. So it has a really, you know, a hardcore, tangible impact on a day-to-day basis in people's lives. And if we look at the sort of techniques that are in play, there's actually a quite a wide variety of them. So if we look at the prevalence of techniques sort of roughly by breaches, you know, compromised credentials and account takeovers, it's by far the number one cause. It's in at least 20% of all breaches that we've seen over the last year. And then, you know, further down, we've got things like phishing and business email compromise and just plain old cloud misconfiguration. And then there are some of the more traditional techniques that we've seen historically as well for you know, attacking databases. When we talk about compromised credentials, what we're saying there is that an attacker is using some sort of stolen credential to gain access to a target. So those credentials can come from a public data breach, they can come from version control, maybe business email compromise or phishing, or just a smaller part of a larger system that they've managed to compromise and be able to extract credentials from those. And this has got one of the longest lag times out of all the different ways that you can potentially be compromised. The average time to discovery is roughly 250 days, and it takes a fair while to clean up on that as well. So, you know, and part of the reason that it can be so difficult to diagnose and recognize that there are compromised credentials in play, and one of the reasons that attackers love this particular type of compromise is that from the inside, it looks like normal activity. It just looks like normal credentials that are being used by authorized users to perform particular tasks. And so it can be difficult to tell the difference between, you know, a real person doing something on a day-to-day basis using the credentials that they have and the systems that they've got access to versus an attacker that's actually impersonating them. So that's why compromised credentials, top of the pops there when it comes to the different techniques for compromises. Cloud misconfiguration as well. We've all heard, you know, stories probably on a weekly basis now about like open S3 buckets and things like that and people leaving dumps, you know, of significant quantities of data in those. If we talk about like the misconfiguration there, we're talking about like default out of the box configuration. Unfortunately, a lot of the cloud providers are doing a lot of work in that space, like particularly AWS with S3 has done a whole bunch of work over the last sort of 12, 18 months to make that better. So it's actually, you really have to work hard to get your data public. You have to actually actively work against the security controls when you're setting up an S3 bucket. But also just the plain old unused features of things that are provisioned. So, you know, you might sign up to a product and or be using a part of a cloud service and you're only using like 40% of it. And meanwhile, the other 60% that you're not using is there and enabled. And that creates a potential for a foothold for an attacker because it's a larger attack surface for them to gain access to. But also you're not using that other stuff. So you're not necessarily even going to be aware that the attacker is operating that particular part of the product that you've, you know, left unused and misconfigured. The last bit here is testing as well. So if the cloud resources that you created, you don't have some sort of automated test against that, maybe some sort of static security analysis, you just simply don't know what you don't know. And that sort of cloud misconfiguration leads to all sorts of interesting like exposure of information and an attacker being able to gain access. Obviously, the average time to discovery is a bit less on that. It's about 186 days, but still pretty high. It's about half a year before, you know, from accidentally misconfiguring something to discovering that somebody's taken advantage of that and starting the remediation process. And then we've got the golden oldies of like SQL injections. So we're talking about like malicious user input used in SQL queries to be able to expose data. And you know, that could be used to exfil, to tamper with the data, to escalate privileges potentially. It's still a really long time for the discovery on that as well. You know, even with all of the modern database technology and ORMs and web application firewalls, there are still a bunch of SQL injection that slips through. Other sort of common attacks that we've seen that are, you know, haven't, and we don't hear so much about them, I guess, anymore, but they are there and they are an active part of you know, people's or attackers and red teamers' tool belts is things like person in the middle attacks, where an observer is able to view data in transit and manipulate data in the request and response to be able to gain additional access or to be able to expose some of that data. The last one here is denial of service as well, which, you know, they happen all the time. It's a big part of the reason why the CDN industry is what it is. They do a great job of absorbing a lot of that traffic. But the whole purpose of that is to make the service unavailable for legitimate users, typically through some sort of resource exhaustion. But the interesting part of this is that in more sophisticated operations, we actually see the denial of service is used as a cover to either do some sort of remote code execution or to exfil. So they're tying up the incident responders with a bunch of different, you know, with a denial of service attack. And that's the thing that everybody's paying attention to because the site appears to be down and is down for a wide variety of the users. Meanwhile, the attackers, that's just a cover. They're actually exfilling data or performing some other nefarious action. So denial of service still a really important part of the tool belt for attackers. So with that in mind, there are a whole bunch of big API security advances that have happened over the last decade, and we're going to talk about the top four of those for the rest of this talk today. And the reason that we want to do that is that if we can understand what those API security improvements have been, we can try and learn from that and apply those to the database space as well. So we're going to start here with the standardized serialization formats, top of the pops. So when we talk about standardized serialization formats, we're basically talking about strongly typed communication of data. So we're talking about while it's in on the wire for some sort of network transport or just how it's actually stored on disk. And the reason that we do this is that it actually reduces the attack surface. It definitely helps with mitigating attacks like SQL injection, because if you've got a strongly typed encoding of the data, potentially that stops a whole bunch of different types of injection class of attacks on that data, because in that serialization and deserialization, it often, it's done in such a way that it stops a lot of these attacks in their tracks. And so there are a couple of real-world examples of that, protocol buffers. So here we're talking about a binary representation of the data structure. So the way that typically works is that you describe a data structure for the input and the output of a particular function. And we're using the built-in types here. So we can see here on the right here, we've got a high-level request. We're constructing this data structure of a search request here. It's got a bunch of required fields, so a bunch of strings and integers. And they've got these tag numbers on the side here as well that are saying this is in this particular field, this is what this actually means. And in the protocol buffers world, you use the built-in tooling from that whole tool chain to compile bindings to other languages to be able to encode and decode that. And it comes up with a very efficient binary format for doing that encode and decode. The other nice thing with this approach as well is it's supporting these basic backwards compatibility as well through tags. So as long as you're not overloading various tags there, you can keep adding new things and deprecating things. And clients are going to be able to handle that relatively transparently. Another example in this space is BSON, which you may have run into in some form, may not necessarily even realize that you have. So it's a much more lightweight binary representation of data structures. So we're talking about that binary encoding of something that is JSON-like. The big difference between BSON and protocol buffers is the protocol buffers will actually strip out the field names. That's why we're actually using the tags here for the numeric ID of what the field is. That actually gets encoded as a binary. But in the BSON world, we're actually encoding the entire field name. And BSON leaves a bit more work to the people that are using it to handle the martial and unmartial serialization and deserialization of that data. It doesn't have any sort of automated tool chain like what you've got in protocol buffers. And that brings a whole bunch of advantages as well. So you don't have to be as prescriptive. You don't have to have protocol buffer support in all the different languages that you're potentially using. So that's what's happened in the API space. And let's look at how we can actually apply that to databases. Well, the real advantage for taking these standardized serialization formats and applying them to databases is that it actually allows us to build secure clients faster. Particularly in the protocol buffer space, it means that we can automatically generate clients for different languages as well as generate documentation as well, both of the input and output, but also the overall service. And we're going to talk about that a second with RPC. Plus, it has this backwards compatibility baked in, which is really, really important for when we're introducing breaking and potentially non-breaking changes. And the serialization formats help us defend against a bunch of different classes of attacks, particularly deserialization. So it allows us to stop a bunch of data injection attacks because we're only supporting primitive data types, but also privilege escalation. And this is it's not necessarily an obvious one, but often one of the ways that attackers are able to gain a foothold in the system is that they are taking advantage of object deserialization at the other end. So through that object deserialization, you basically encode a malicious object into the message that you're sending to the API, or in this case, a database. And then when it gets decoded at the other end and deserialized, potentially, if the object is crafted in the right way, you can actually gain remote code execution abilities. So a serialization format like protobufs, BSON, Avro, they all do a really good job at eliminating that particular, or at least massively reducing the likelihood of that class of attack being realized in the real world. The other bit here is denial of service attacks. So one of the ways that you try and exhaust resources of a resource or an asset that you're trying to compromise is you feed it a whole bunch of garbage data. So if you're doing a strict encoding and decoding of that data, we can actually just drop bad data on the floor and log it. That actually gives us, from a blue teamers, from a defender's perspective, a whole bunch of extra insight into the behavior of attackers, people that might be trying to compromise the systems that we're defending. The other thing to consider, though, is that you can't just use those standard serialization formats. You've got to actually, probably to get that extra level of security, you need to go a bit deeper. So if you're thinking in defense in depth, using strongly typed languages to stop those injection attacks propagating from both the client to the server. So you can't rely purely on things like protobufs to stop those sort of serialization attacks in their tracks. You've got to rely as well on the strong typeness of the languages that you're using. So if you're not using a strongly typed language and you're handling input from users or things that are untrusted, you should seriously consider doing that. The other interesting thing here is request smuggling, which is a class of attack that has been around for sort of about 15 years, but it has sort of seen a bit of resurgence in the last 12, 18 months. And so the idea there is that you're able to, using HTTP headers, trick a server into passing extra bits of information to requests further downstream. So maybe the outer shell you're able to of an application or a series of microservices you're able to compromise in such a way that you can have more malicious data propagate further downstream. So we mostly see that in the world where it's the translation between HTTP 2 and HTTP 3 back to HTTP 1. So a lot of the attacks around request smuggling are HTTP 1 focused, but I have a hunch that we'll see a few more of these attacks in the HTTP 2 space in the next year or two. So I alluded to this earlier, but the next major area is RPC, or remote procedure calls. So the historical way that we've sort of approached this is that when we're dealing with an API, we're doing a single request and response. So we're doing that, way back in the day with something like CORBA, something perhaps a little bit more modern like SOAP, and then XML RPC. And finally, REST. And all of these are just using the basic building blocks of the web to be able to provide web services and APIs. And in the database space, we also see unique wire protocols across all the different databases. And in fact, there is some convergence there, like the MySQL and Postgres wire protocols end up being adopted by other more modern databases like CockroachDB or Azure Cosmos. But there's a quite a wide proliferation of different wire protocols that are out there. And now in this new world of RPC, we use a lot of code generation to handle things like what our routing looks like, serialization and deserialization, often with these standard deserialization formats that I was talking about before, as well as handling the HTTP methods, the request and response headers, and probably most importantly, from a defender's perspective, errors. So what are the actual errors that you emit from your API when something goes wrong? And so a concrete example of that is something like gRPC, which has definitely seen a lot of uptake in the API space, particularly in the systems engineering side of things over the last couple of years. So it uses protobufs and it requires HTTP2 because it allows for bidirectional streaming. So it's not just a simple request response. It's an ongoing conversation. And that's one of the advantages that you get with doing this over HTTP2. The other main example here is less well known, though, is a thing called TWRP from Twitch. And so it supports both binary and JSON payloads. It is actually HTTP 1.1 only. has no support for bi-directional streaming. The one advantage of that, though, is that you can actually talk to a TWRP-based API just using the standard utilities that you've probably been used to all this time. So curl works. You can talk to a TWRP-based RPC endpoint with curl really easily. You can't really do that with gRPC, although there are some other utilities like gRP curl that allows you to do gRPC to a curl-like experience to gRPC endpoints. The last one that I want to mention very quickly is GraphQL, which you're probably all familiar with in one way or another. So similar idea, single API endpoint. The interesting thing about GraphQL is the clients can request the data and the structure that that data is returned in. So you see a query on the left here where we're saying I'm doing a query for a person with the name and the height, and that's what the response gets encoded as a JSON object on the way back. One useful thing about this is that it allows you to add and remove fields and types without affecting the existing queries that you've got. So if we take that gRPC approach and we try applying it to databases, one of the huge advantages here is that we were able to ensure protocol compatibility between the clients and the servers, so forcing clients to upgrade to the latest versions, as well as reducing the attack surface to only the things that the gRPC or TWRP are explicitly exposing, which is great to stop enumeration attacks, which is also one of the other big classes of attacks that attackers use to understand what the broader environment that a particular endpoint is operating in. And this is great for defending against things like broken authentication, so for managing like session timeouts to limit the foothold of potential attackers, broken access controls as well, so having more scoped and stringly enforced credentials, and also denial of service, which I touched on before about the strict encoding and the deserialization and the logging of that. There are some downsides that you need to consider as well. Like one of the things that people often forget with deploying gRPC is they have a gRPC endpoint deployed with reflection, which actually allows you to enumerate all of the gRPC services that you're potentially talking to. It also exposes the protocol buffers in a human readable format as well, so what the arguments in the fields are. So if you are running a gRPC endpoint, make sure that where it's running in prod, that you've got gRPC reflection turned off as well. But this whole RPC approach, there's actually an open source database out there called ProfaneDB that actually uses protobufs and gRPC together quite nicely. So you actually define the database schema in protobufs, and then you end up talking to ProfaneDB using gRPC, and it's actually using another lower level database called RocksDB behind the scenes to actually do the storage of the data on disk. The third out of four that we're going to talk about is auth really quickly. So authentication before, we typically see challenge response auth authentication. So do you know what the password is? Yes, this is what the password is, basic challenge response. There's more interesting ways that you don't see is deployed quite as widely, like secure remote password, which is basically a zero knowledge proof of saying, do you know what this password is? And we can sort of compute values and share them with one another to say, yes, I know what the password is, but I'm not actually going to send what the password is over the wire. And the last traditional way that we've approached this is client certificate authentication, where you're using the TLS certs from a certificate authority to say that these two clients this client and server are well trusted to talk to one another. And more recently, some of the big advances that we've seen here is this widespread adoption of OAuth 2 and JSON Web Tokens, as well as SAML. Probably the most impactful thing in the identity space in the last 10 years has been the self-managed identity. So rather than having standalone system accounts with shared credentials, we're actually able to tie identity back to individuals in our organizations. And often that's through things like 0365 or Azure Active Directory or G Suite. And from that, we've seen a proliferation of third-party identity providers as well. So things like Auth0, Ping, and Okta. And so how can we apply that to databases? Well, we think about authentication for databases. You don't want to roll your own authentication, right? So we want to work in a world where we have untrusted clients and trusted servers. So the client authenticates to an IDP. The IDP sets up a session with the database, but the database itself gets to remain ignorant of the users. It only knows that the IDP has said, yes, this particular token that I've been given is legit and we're good to go. And this provides a whole bunch of benefits as well. So less code, you don't have to maintain all of your own authentication code, and lower ongoing costs. And the databases themselves become more integrated with the broader organizational control or IAM controls. So you know that if a particular employee leaves, you don't have to roll all the credentials for access to that database. You just get to disable that account. And in theory, if there aren't any other accounts that are floating around that they potentially have access to, that employee doesn't have access anymore. It turns out that you can actually use this approach for a bunch of quite well-known databases already out there. So MongoDB, OpenSearch, which is Amazon's version of Elasticsearch, and CouchDB all support JWT-based authentication, which is actually quite impressive. And for defending against what this allows us to defend against, we're talking about broken authentication here. So we're limiting the impact of compromised credentials, which again happen in 20% of all breaches and account takeovers, as well as broken access controls and like privilege escalation, yada, yada, yada. So the last bit that I'm going to talk about very quickly is TLS everywhere. Hello, that's a new one. My key has literally just popped off my keyboard while I'm very aggressively tapping forward to the next slide. So I'm going to try and do it in such a way that it doesn't go too far. Hey, there we go. All right, TLS before. So previously, certificates were really, really costly. And in fact, the main reason that we haven't seen such a huge adoption of TLS until recently is it's an economic barrier, not a technical or usability one. So organizations end up economizing by not using TLS everywhere. So they end up doing TLS termination of the load balancers, and everything from the load balancers inside is unencrypted. And because of this, because we haven't needed to roll that many certificates out because it's been quite costly to do that, we end up with quite poor automation for managing the certificate lifecycle overall. And worse still, we see poor visibility into the certificate supply chain. Now, certificates are basically free. You know, Let's Encrypt has done an amazing job in lowering that cost to the point that all the other certificate providers have tried to meet them there as well. Which meant that we've seen this proliferation of end-to-end TLS and a better developer experience overall, because we're rotating certs pretty regularly with the likes of Let's Encrypt for your stuff in production, but also just your local dev experience with like MK certs, or being able to use real TLS certificates locally in development and have it not throw up a whole bunch of errors while you're doing that. So how does that work in a database world? Well, obviously we can keep doing the thing that a lot of database servers already do, which is terminate TLS in the database itself. The interesting thing that we start being able to do is to actually move the certificate lifecycle, managing that into the database service itself. So rather than having somebody in like an ops and infrastructure role handle rolling out the latest certificates and making sure that it's updated everywhere, and you're maybe using some sort of configuration management utility for that, the database server itself has got, say, a client to Let's Encrypt to be able to get the latest cert and go through the whole ACME challenge process and whatnot to be able to securely get a new certificate. And which meant that, you know, we can use all of this well-automated PKI infrastructure. The other useful thing here is that we can start using, strictly using forward secrecy ciphers. So like Diffie-Hellman encryption, elliptic curve Diffie-Hellman, which is really useful for replay attacks that you see with, say, TLS. You've got to use TLS 1.2 and onwards. But basically, it means that if an attacker is able to snoop your traffic and then gets access to the keys at some point in the future, they won't be able to read the previously encrypted traffic. They'll only be able to see new stuff going forward. So this also affects, you know, you all know about TLS. You should just use it. It's like a no-brainer. If you're not using TLS everywhere, that is probably your number one takeaway from this whole talk. The other bit here is impersonation, actually, which is we can actually start looking at certificate transparency logs for the for compromised certificate authorities. So almost at the end. But the thing to consider here with TLS is that it also allows us easier passive asset discovery. So cert transparency logs end up making it a bit easier to find assets that are potentially available out there, doing it entirely passively without necessarily probing those. So if you haven't played with Subfinder, I highly recommend you check that out as well. And the last bit here is zero trust. So the whole idea is that if we're able to layer all these different security controls on top of one another when we're building new databases, we can build them like we are intending to put them on the public internet. So all of your input is untrusted and we're sanitizing everything. And potentially it means that we can start putting the databases on the public internet themselves. Thank you very much. Can you hear what questions you've got?
Yeah, awesome. Thank you, Lindsay. I've got
Siri going off and my
Siri's trying to get involved.
Bye, Siri. Go away.
Yeah, so First question, for organizations looking to implement some kind of upgrade to their database security, what would be like the first step? You can do it now. You can do it right now. Would it be like the lowest barrier to introducing this, but the highest impact on security? What would
you say? I can say that without a doubt, it is going to be making sure that you're using TLS everywhere, and you're using the automation that's out there to do that really easily these days. The other big thing as well is in the identity and access management space. So if you are able to use some sort of third-party authentication service and integrate your database access, and the identity access to that through that sort of third-party service, that'll give you a massive uplift as well.
Awesome. Another question that I also am interested in. One of your first slides was just the terrifying numbers of financial impact upon breaches. The healthcare was surprisingly more than double that of the financial sector. I was wondering, do you have any information why that is such a marked increase over finance?
Yeah, that's a really good question. I think part of the reason that that it's so much more expensive actually comes down to incident response. Incident response in healthcare tends actually to cost a fair bit more, just because there's so many. It tends to be so many legacy systems in play, and so many different third-party providers. Because in a lot of healthcare settings, technology is not considered a core competency. So there's a whole array of different providers that they need to interface with to actually evict an attacker and be able to get operational, get up and running operationally again.
Makes sense. Awesome. Thank you, Lindsay. There are other questions, but unfortunately, we've run out of time. Maybe any other questions, people could put them in the chat, and perhaps you'd be able to check those out. So thank you.
Not a problem. Thank you, Chris.